see from the word of God that these other men and women experience like situations, like circumstances, and it's also revealed to us through the word of God, as we were teaching last week on the instructional word in Hebrews chapter 4, because not just us, it's not just us who experience things in our lives, even though they're challenging and all the other descriptive words we can use, challenging, hard, trying, a struggle, all these different things. We also read in the Bible that other believers had those same struggles. Maybe a different era, different time, different generation. Nevertheless, many of the same struggles as they walk with God in their generation. So that's what I really, really, really like about the book of Hebrews, that it's relatable. It's relatable for you and I. And that's what we want to, that's how we want to teach the book of Hebrews, the epistle, the letter to the Hebrew Christians. We are living Hebrews. Maybe not born, physically born into the Hebrew nation, but we are spiritual Hebrews because we are children of God. And the promises that God made to them, those promises he also makes to us, and even more. And that's what we're going to discover here tonight as we look at Hebrews chapter 10. And we look at an amazing reality. So I'm excited just about that title. I was praying today, and last night. I woke up early this morning, 3 o'clock or whatever this morning, or I don't know when it was, but it was the sun wasn't up, and I was going through Hebrews chapter 10, and God just really been dealing with my heart, and it was exciting. It was exciting. And as I was praying throughout the day, I said, what can I, God, give me a title for this. Oftentimes as human beings, we attach ourselves to, say, a title or a topic, and or even a topic and then a title within that topic. Like our topic is right now, our topic is studying the book of Hebrews, right? Those Hebrew Christians. Talking about their faith, talking about what they were going through, talking about the word of God as it pertained to their lives. So that's the topic. And then within that topic, we have titles, right? The instructional word of God and just different things. And tonight, an amazing reality. So that's what we want to focus on tonight as we look at Hebrews chapter 10, an amazing reality, an amazing reality. So thank God for this amazing reality. The reality in Christ, brothers and sisters, that's exactly what it is. It supersedes religion. There is a difference between religion and reality. Religion, being religious, simply defined, can be simply defined as just going through the motions. We go to work religiously. We eat religiously. There's various things that we do religiously, and we don't even think about it, or it's a part of our culture, right? We are taught things culturally that become religious for us to do. All right. It's like many African Americans, Black Americans, however you want to label it, Blacks, even though we don't know each other, we didn't grow up in the same area, same region in the country, there are many things that that's relatable to us. When I was a clinical chaplain at the hospital, oftentimes I would get a request to go into some of the African American Black Americans rooms and just talk with them, be present with them, and oftentimes encourage them, pray for them, whatever, just be there for them. And one particular time, a Caucasian white nurse went in there with me, and it was a young lady, early 30s, dealing with some serious clinical issues. So she was pretty down being in her early 30s with this condition. So I started talking to her about food, right? Collard greens and just different things that I figured she can relate to, and we can have a conversation, even though she had never met me, never heard of me, whatever. And after the conversation, after about 40 minutes, an hour conversation, the nurse and I left out of the room, and she goes, "I thought you said you didn't know her." I said, "I don't know her." I said, "But there are many things that we're, as Blacks, Black Americans, we can relate to because we've been culturally exposed to. So therefore, there are things that, because we've been culturally exposed to these things, we can have a conversation because truly they're a part of our culture, our religion, if you please. Be it collard greens, we're talking about collard greens and hot sauce and all the different, some of the basic food products, like what's served at a Black funeral, right? Fried chicken, some type of bread roll, green beans. You know, there's set things that's served. Sometimes you throw spaghetti in there if someone is really courageous to do that. So there's different things that we can relate to, be it music, just attitudes and family members, family experiences. We can relate to that just because of our cultural upbringing, not necessarily geographical upbringing, but cultural. So I'm saying that to say we do things religiously without even thinking about them because we've been influenced by our culture. Well, the same thing was transpired here in the book of Hebrews. These Jewish Christians, they have been exposed culturally to some things, and it's hard to break those cultures, right? And sometimes we don't need to break those cultures because they're not sinful. Those cultural things, they are a part of us. They help us to identify. They help us to know where we came from. And knowing where we came from and knowing the struggles of others and knowing the challenges, it helps us to appreciate today. And that's what we also see here in the book of Hebrews. It exposes us to, in the midst of all the trials, in the midst of all the challenges, in the midst of all the struggles, in the midst of all the failures, in the midst of all the discouraging times, all these negative things that we all experience in our lives, here in the book of Hebrews, it reminds us that through it all, we have the victory in Christ. So these Hebrew Christians, these Jews, they had cultural experiences, and it's easy to lean on those cultural experiences, and it's easy to revert back to those cultural experiences when times get tough, just like us. Times get tough, we want to circle the wagons and go back into our cultural comforts, be it food, be it surroundings, whatever it might be, because we're comfortable with that culture and comfortable with that religious atmosphere. That's why we see, I believe, in my opinion, that's why we see, I hear a lot of people talking about this church and that church and this pastor and that pastor, and I really don't want to hear that. Although that's their experience, I understand what they're saying. A lot of times they're venting, so I do listen, but I don't want to hear it. Why? Because when times get tough, at times, when times get tough, even though there's issues and problems and things that have been identified within those congregations, I know amongst the Black community, not all, but a large majority of the Black community, they'll still fall back and go to those churches versus, okay, they got all these problems and all these things, and I've told this other pastor about all these things this pastor is doing in the congregation and the mother of the church and this one and that one's doing. Then why are you going back? Why are you going back? You just painted this picture, this factual picture. I pray it was factual picture and not gossip. Then when things got tough over here, why did you revert back over there? Why? Because it's culturally comfortable. It's religion. And that's what we read about here in the book of Hebrews. They were on the verge of going back to their cultural comfortability, falling back to their previous religion. All right, so let's get into Hebrews chapter 10. There was a question. So let me look at the question here. I will read the question since I did say let's open for questions. So there's a question. How do we balance faith with reality? All right, good question. Balancing faith with reality. All right, let's talk about that. Good question. So, first of all, and we're going to get to Hebrews 10. We're going to just incorporate all this. So, first of all, faith, as we read Hebrews chapter 11, thank you for the question because we can explore the book of Hebrews as well as the whole Bible. So, as we read the, as we look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it tells us faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Also, we read in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I believe it's verse 7, that we walk by faith and not by sight. So you've heard me share this. I believe you've heard me share this numerous times. I'll share it again. Repetition is always a good teacher. Faith, summarized up, faith is belief, trust, and confidence. If and when a person says, I have faith, be it I have faith in God, I have faith in a person, I have a faith in a system, what have you, faith, what they're saying is that, what I'm saying when I say that, is that I believe in that person, I trust that person, I have confidence in that person. And it may be a situational thing. I have faith that they're going to come through in this particular situation. I have faith they have proven themselves. I believe, I trust, I have confidence that they're going to do everything they can to fulfill the promise that they said they would do. And if they can't, then they'll let me know. So I have faith, I have belief, I have trust, I have confidence. For me, that's a simple explanation of faith that can be translated from the Old Testament as well as the New Testament as we read about those of faith, right? Men and women of faith, those who trusted in God, those who believed in God, those who had confidence that Jesus would never leave them nor forsake them, Hebrews chapter 13. All right. So, balancing faith with reality. So, that's in essence, that's what faith is, right? And the Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verse 17, faith, belief, trust, and confidence comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So, we develop our faith, our spiritual faith, our spiritual belief, our spiritual trust, our spiritual confidence is developed through the Word of God, through our exposure of the Word of God. And our exposure of the Word of God, be it reading the Word of God, studying the Word of God, hearing the Word of God, input of the Word of God in us, it develops faith, belief, trust, and confidence in us. At the same time as that faith is developed in us, we gain a greater reality in God. So faith produces a reality in God. Excuse me, in us. The word reality comes from the word real. Real. So the more we read the Word of God, the more we're exposed to the Word of God, the more, this is kind of a bad sentence structure, the more God is real to us. The realer. How about that? How about that for a word? The realer God is to us. The more we read about how he responded to various ones in the Old Testament and the New Testament, and in our own personal lives and in the lives of those we know we prayed for, he becomes that much more real to us. So balancing faith with reality, actually, our reality in God is dependent upon our faith in God. I'll say it again. The reality that we have in God, this amazing reality that we have in God, is dependent upon our belief system in God, our trust system in God, the confidence that we have in God. Notice as we go to in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, the Bible says, "For by grace, the grace of God, we are saved," right? So grace, and I'm going to talk about that in just a moment. Grace provides an opportunity for all mankind to accept Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. John chapter 3, verse 16, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world," we can put entire human race there. We can insert that. "For God so loved the entire human race that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish." Now, the entire human race was perishing, but God has provided an opportunity through his Son that whosoever believes in him, whosoever has faith in him, will not perish, but have everlasting life. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. "For with the mouth confession is made, and with the heart man believes," right? "That God raised Jesus from the dead." Romans chapter 10, verse 9, Romans chapter 10, verse 13. So our faith, and thank you for asking this question, because the book of Hebrews deals with faith, right? Because again, the reality that we have in God is dependent upon our faith in God. If a person doesn't have faith in God, then God's not going to be real to them. He's not really going to, in real time, as they use today, they won't believe that he'll come through for them. Now, religiously, we'll say, well, God's got it, but do you believe in your heart? Do you trust him? Do you have confidence? That's the difference between religion, a religious statement, and a statement of in reality, right? A statement in reality is based on that individual's faith. That individual believes God. They trust God. They have confidence in God. God is real to them based on their faith. We know God is real, but how real is he to you as an individual is determined by your faith. It's not determined by you going to church. It's not determined by you being here on this platform with me. Although going to church, being on this platform, going to Bible study, what does it do? It exposes us more to the Word of God So therefore, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So going to church, being in Bible study, being on this platform, it presents more opportunity for us to build up our most holy faith, he said in Jude 23, 24, somewhere, June 20, excuse me. Build up our most holy faith, our most holy trust, our most holy belief, our most holy confidence in God. And that makes God more real to us. He's real, he becomes real. So hopefully I answered that particular question. How do we balance faith with reality? So our reality in God, now there's another reality, right? The reality of the world that we're living in and the challenges that we have in this world. Let me give you scripture. So if we get to Hebrews chapter 10, we'll get to it, but this is good. So let's look at the reality of life. How about that? So I talked about our reality in God, how real God is to us based on our faith in God. So let's talk about the reality of life, because with the reality of life means what? There's ups and there's downs. There's trials, there's temptations, there's obstacles, there's challenges, there's struggles, there's all these things, right, in life. So how do we balance our faith in God or our faith in general? Let's just say God, our faith in God, that's what we're talking about, with the reality of life. Once again, we must, as a believer, it is imperative that we return to the Word of God. Because the reality of life is too much for us to bear on our own. So, dealing with the reality of life, the ups, the downs, the struggles, the up, all the things that life brings, as a believer, one must condition themselves, one must train themselves to always look to the Word of God. Let me give you a scripture. So the Bible says, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. I'm going to go ahead and turn and read to it. So 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, and then I'll read Romans chapter 8, verse 28. All right. Dealing with the reality of life. And where's the answers? They're in the Word of God. So even though, or not even though, as we deal with life, which we all do, as a believer in Christ, we are still to look to the Word of God to help us balance and stay balanced in life. So the Word of God helps us stay balanced as we navigate life. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. There have no temptation taking you, but such as common to man. So he lets us know there in the first part of this scripture, excuse me, that every temptation, every trying time that you and I experience, others have experienced that before. And we read that in the Bible. We read that in Hebrews, right? We read it throughout the 66 books in the Bible, the ups and downs, the challenges, the reality of life that those individuals were dealing with as they navigated life. We read that. So here in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, it lets us know. He says, there's no temptation, no trying times, no struggle, no challenges that you've experienced, but such as common to man, especially common to the believer, but not just the believer in Christ, but to all people. See, brothers and sisters, as a Christian, it doesn't mean that we're exempt from the challenges of life. as a Christian, it means that we have consolation and we have someone to go to and turn to provide us comfort and help as we navigate the challenges of life. That's a big difference. That's a big difference. So there is no temptation taking you, but such is common to man. Here's the second part of that scripture. But God. But God is what? God is faithful. So he's instructing us, going back to last week's Bible study, he's instructing us. The word of God is is an instructional word. He's instructing us that, and letting us know, informing us, excuse me, he's informing us that, yes, you're tempted just like everyone else in the world currently, as well as before, and even those who will down the road. But God is faithful, who will not suffer or allow you to be tempted. So God is allowing us to be tried. God is allowing us to have struggles. We can believe that. That's a fact. Because in our struggles, we're more dependent upon God, right? 2 Corinthians chapter 12. What did he tell Paul? My grace is sufficient for thee. It's when you are weak, then I'm able to be strong in you. So when we are weak, when we are tempted and we're tried and we're pulled and we're stretched and all these things, we begin to go to the Word of God and we look to Jesus to help us. We look to Jesus to unleash the power of the Holy Spirit to comfort us, to give us a peace that passes all understanding, to restore the joy of the Lord in our soul. All these different things that we ask of Him, we're dependent upon Him because life has robbed them from us. So God is faithful, God is trustworthy, God is believable. We can have confidence that God will make a way of escape so that we're able to endure. Let's read it. But God is faithful, who will not suffer or allow you to be tempted above that you're able. So when I read that, what it tells me that as I navigate life, Doug Perkins, as you navigate life and you experience challenges, you don't like them. They're tough on your flesh. They're mentally taxing. They bring a weariness and fatigue to you. Absolutely. But as I read these words in the Bible, it lets me know that God sees something in me that I don't see in myself. He sees the potential for me to grow, to develop, and He'll give me the spiritual strength, the spiritual fortitude, the mental fortitude, the emotional fortitude to overcome these things. And not just me, but every one of us. He said, God, who is faithful, he will not allow you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation, he will also make a way of escape. Two points there. He says, he's not going to allow you to be tempted more than you can bear, even though your envelope is being pushed, even though you're hanging on the cliff with your fingertips, or as they say, with the skin of your teeth. I don't understand. I don't have any skin on my teeth, but I use fingertips, right? When it feels that way, God is still with us. Hebrews 13, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And he'll make a way of escape. It's when we're on that cliff with hanging on our fingertips and we feel like we're going to fall, and we're kicking our legs. God, all of a sudden, put a shelf there and you rest your feet on it. He'll make a way of escape that ye may be able to bear it. He didn't save us to destroy us. God saved us, number one, to be in harmony with him for eternity, to make it to heaven until we get there, brothers and sisters. Second part of that salvation is for us to labor for him to make a difference and have an influence in the lives of others, to lift up Jesus, John chapter 12, verse 32, to lift up Jesus so that others will come to this reality. Not religion, but that they will come to the reality that God is faithful, that God will help them balance their lives with the Word of God as they navigate the challenges of life. And as our faith developed in God, their faith can develop in God as well. For he said, he's not a respecter of persons. So the formula for me living for God, having faith in God, believing in God, trusting in God, having confidence in God, is the same formula for every individual. There's no difference. God's not a respecter of persons. So here in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, it lets us know that we will be tempted. And this is just one place. You can find other places. 1 John, we will be tempted. We will be tried. There will be struggles. There will be obstacles. But God is faithful. So here's the conditioning of the Word of God in our hearts, in our minds, in our souls. And this is also where the Holy Spirit, John chapter 14, verse 26, the Holy Spirit, who is the comforter, how does he comfort us? He comforts us with the Word of God. The comforter will bring to your remembrance, to our remembrance, and teach us whatsoever Jesus said. So the Holy Spirit uses the Word of God, which is what? The sword of the Spirit, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17, 18. To do what? To comfort us, to remind us. That's what the book of Hebrews is all about. It's a book of remembrance, to remind us and to put us on the offensive of that problem, of that struggle, of that trial, of that temptation, so that those negative things that appear in our lives as we navigate life, they will not get the best of us. They will not dominate us. The Holy Spirit divinely intervenes with the Word of God and puts us on the offensive versus the defensive. Romans chapter 8, verse 28 states this: for we know all things work together for the good. All things work. Did you hear what I said? Do you hear what the Bible says? We know. We can take those, we can take the three words there. For we know. Stop and teach a Bible study. To know is powerful. To have knowledge is powerful. When I was in New Orleans, I remember hearing a commercial. It was a part of the HBCU marketing system, commercial marketing system. And I forgot who said, maybe Maya Jackson. I don't remember exactly who made the statement, but they said, a mind is a great thing to waste. Basically saying, constantly gain knowledge, be learning. For the mind is a terrible thing to waste. Notice what Jesus said. That statement is a statement based on the principles of the Word of God, based on knowing. So I mentioned to you Romans chapter 8, verse 28, for we know. Stop there. Jesus said in John chapter 8, verse 32, he said, know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Oftentimes, people quote the second part of that scripture, the truth will make me free, but you have to know it. You have to believe it. You have to embrace it. So to know, embrace, spiritually, intimately know the truth. The truth is Jesus Christ. The truth is the Word of God. Jesus is the Word of God. So to know the truth, to know Jesus, to believe, to trust, to have confidence in the truth, in Jesus, in his word, will make us free in the midst of that struggle, in the midst of that temptation. Why? Because go back to Romans 8:28. For we know there's power in the word know when it comes to the Bible. We know what? That all things will work together for the good. Now, we know all things will work together for the good by faith, because it's not dependent upon us working it out. It's not dependent upon us figuring it out. It's dependent upon us believing God to divinely intervene in that particular situation, in that particular circumstance. So he said, for we know all things will, not possibly, not maybe, not dependent on my bank account, not dependent on the national economic system, not dependent on who's president, not dependent on all these external things. We know all things will work together for the good. For the good to them who love God. So it's conditional. It's conditional. Divine intervention is conditional. He said, for we know all things will work together for the good to them who love God. I know we want all things to work together for the good for all people, and there's a scripture to support that. Romans chapter 2, verse 4, the Bible says the forbearance and the goodness of God leads men and women to repentance. But I'm talking about for us believers who are going through it. We rest upon the scriptures, right? So we're living in a reality of, say, hypothetically, or maybe not even hypothetically, I'm struggling with something. There's an adverse situation, adverse circumstance, trying. Maybe it's my children. Maybe it's my personal life. Maybe it's my spouse. Maybe it's on the job. Maybe it's my neighbors. Whatever. It's uncomfortable. It's income. Excuse me. It's inconvenient, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We know God will divinely intervene and work that thing together for your good because you love God. That's the condition. You met the condition for God to work it together for the good. For those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Now, that calling is not limited or is not expressly to call to be a pastor, called to be an evangelist. No, the first call of God is to salvation. Before any title, before any position, one has to be saved and know Jesus as their savior. And then he will place you in the various offices that he so choose. So balancing faith with reality, reality in God, reality in life. Faith is a powerful thing that we possess in our lives because faith, our belief, our trust, our confidence gives us a greater reality in God, and our faith helps us in the reality of life as we navigate life and experience adverse times, adverse struggles, adverse situations. Very good question, because that's exactly what the Hebrew Christians were dealing with here. They were facing challenging times. Yes, they were believers, but the reality, excuse me, the reality of what they were going through was putting them on the verge of returning back to Judaism. Back to Judaism. So let me just dive into it just quickly here. Quickly here, Hebrews chapter 10. Hopefully, I answered that question. I can go on and on, but I just want to read a few scriptures here. Very good. Based on that question, faith with reality. And I like that. I really do like that because those type of questions and questions in general, brothers and sisters, that's how we really grow in God. I can go and teach you on an expository format. Okay, verse 7 says this, verse 8 says this, this is what it means. But if you don't know how to apply that in your life, if you don't know how to apply that in a situation that you're facing today or that you will face, or a circumstance you're in today, or a circumstance you, then it's of no value. But when we hear the word of God, we're taught the word of God, we believe the word of God, the situation, the circumstances that we're dealing with currently or and will deal with, it gives the Holy Spirit the necessary ammunition. I'm going to use the word ammunition. Or resources to bring to our remembrance, you know what? There's no temptation taking me what I'm going through that others haven't gone through. Okay, God will make a way of escape for me because he's faithful. How do I know he's faithful? Because all things work together for the good to people like me who love God. And I also know that Hebrews 13 says, whether you even know where to quote it or not, I know the Bible says that Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He also said in the same chapter that he's a very present help. What shall man do to me? He says that he will never leave me nor forsake me. So those are things that we need to be reminded of in our walk with God. The Hebrew Christians, that's what this book is all about. He's reminding them. He's reminding them of how good Jesus is. He's reminding them. Let's look at it for a few minutes. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. I'm reading from the King James. For the law, having a shadow of the good things to come and not the very image of those things, can never, with those sacrifices which they offer continually, year by year, make those who come unto it perfect. I'm just going to summarize it just for the sake of time, and I'll take a few more questions if anyone have questions. But let me summarize here what he's saying in Hebrews chapter 10. You can go back and read it. So Hebrews chapter 10, he's making a parallel, and the essence of what he's saying here is that the new covenant, the New Testament, the new promise, all the same thing, new covenant, new testament, new promise that God made with man is greater than the old. The old testament, the old covenant, the old promise that God made to Abraham. So hence, God made a promise to Abraham. We have the dispensation of promise. He made it to Abraham. And as we read there in Genesis, closing out Genesis, moving into Exodus, Moses came on the scene. God gave Moses the law, right? So we have the dispensation of promise. And then that word dispensation is how the time and how God dealt with man. He promised Abraham, and then we move into law, right? The Mosaic law, the law that God gave to Moses, right? For the children of Israel. And they lived under the law all the way up to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Or actually, let me rephrase that. They lived under the law all the way to the point where Jesus was on the cross and he said, "It is finished." What he was saying was, he fulfilled everything in the law and he was bringing in a better covenant, a new testament. a better testament, right? The Old Testament, the Old Covenant was good, but the New Testament is better. Why? Because there's a better sacrifice. And that's what Hebrews chapter 10 is about, right? He says, he's talking about it, he's quoting from Psalm 40, how that they sacrifice goats and bulls and animals, but now God, he said here, let's look at it. Hebrews chapter 10. He said in verse, well, you can read it. I'm not going to go through it all. But he said in verse 7, Jesus said in verse, Jesus speaking, quoting from Psalm 40, I believe it is. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book, it is written of me to do thy will, O God. The same words that Jesus used right in the Garden of Gethsemane when he said, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. He says, nevertheless, after three times, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. This is how the word of God works together and it doesn't contradict itself. So he says, I came to do thy will, O God. And verse 8, and above when he said, sacrifice and offerings and burnt offerings and offerings for sin, you would not have, neither have you pleasure in them, which are offered by the law. So the law was good. It would suffice. They did what God told them to do. Verse 9, he said, then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. The emphasis, he take away the first testament, the Old Testament, that he may establish the second, the New Testament, the new covenant. All right. By the which, verse 10, by the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. So not yearly or annually, but Jesus was that better sacrifice. And this is an amazing reality, brothers and sisters. So the writer, believed to be Paul, he was bringing them back to this amazing reality that you're living a better life. You're under a better testament. Don't return to the law, to the rules and the regulations of the law, because Jesus died and fulfilled that and issued grace. God gave Abraham the promise, he gave Moses the law, and Jesus brought in grace. And we are living under grace. He was telling them, don't forfeit grace as you continue to read Hebrews chapter 10. He says, we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, right? In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35, he says, cast not away your confidence in God, right? Which has great recompense of reward. He says in verse 38, the same thing he said in Romans chapter 5, the same thing he said, and I believe it's in Hosea, he said, and the just shall live by faith, verse 38, right? So he's saying all these things, and he tells them, he said in verse 32 of Hebrews chapter 10, he said, but call to remembrance the former days in which, after ye were illuminated, ye endured such great fight of afflictions. Why? Why are you and I enduring so much in God? Because we have new life. We have a better covenant. We have something to look forward to. That word, that phrase, something to look forward to, is defined as hope. Colossians chapter 1, verse 26, 27. Christ in you, the hope of glory. So, I got my train of thought. So let me look at, I'm sorry. So Hebrews chapter 10, what makes this an amazing reality? It's an amazing reality because of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Let's look at it briefly. He said, if any man be in Christ, not if any man or woman be religious, not if any man or woman is born black, white, Jew, whatever. No, if any man, open for all men and women. That's what the grace of God is. It's open for all men and women. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Just like the Old Testament was fulfilled when he brought in grace, he said, when we receive Christ, this is the amazing reality. The amazing reality is that old things are passed away. So when the devil tries to bring up your past, brother, your brother or sister, you don't have to walk around in that condemnation. Why? Because Romans chapter 8, verse 1 says, now there's no condemnation, there's no guilt to them who are in Christ, who walk after the spirit and not after the flesh. That old man, that old woman, we operated, we lived in our flesh in its entirety. Excuse me. We submitted, we yielded to our flesh. But now in Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, he helps us to die to our flesh daily. Didn't Jesus say that? Jesus said, those who follow me, those who are disciples of mine, they will take up their cross and follow me. They will die daily. So the Holy Spirit helps us to do that in our lives. So this is an amazing reality. So here in Hebrews chapter 10, he's reminding them that you are in Christ. Open your eyes. All things have become new. Old things are past. Then he goes on in 2 Corinthians chapter 18. He says, you, in case you don't understand what I'm saying in verse 17, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, open your eyes. If you can't grasp that concept of opening your eyes, all things have become new, because we know how we get. Well, you don't understand, Pastor, what I did in the past. You don't understand this, and you're letting that thing hang on your that heavy weight hang on you. So 2 Corinthians 5:18, he says, you have been reconciled. You have been restored by God. And now God is also giving you the ministry of reconciliation. And in verse 20, he says, and now you are ambassadors, spokesperson for God, for Christ. So it's an amazing reality. This is real. It's not a life of religion, it's a life of reality. As the question, balancing faith and reality. We talked about it. Well, this is an amazing reality that we can look to God at any time. Do you know you can pray anytime? It doesn't matter what hour. We are subjected to time. It's 7:59 right now. We're subjected to time. God's not. I can pray right now. I can pray at 1 o'clock in the morning. I can pray at 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, 10 o'clock in the morning, 6 o'clock in the evening. God is not subjected to time. That's the reality we have. This reality is, yes, I have a past, you have a past, but that's exactly the reality that Jesus died on the cross, rose from, resurrected on the third day, brought in, issued in grace by faith. We accepted that grace to save us, to make us born again by faith, by our belief, our trust, and our confidence. We confess with our mouth, Romans 10, 9. We believed in our heart, we have faith in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, and therefore he saved us, he delivered us, he liberated us from that old man, that old woman. This is an amazing reality. And Rome and Hebrews chapter 10, Paul was bringing them back to this. You're living an amazing reality. Don't go back to a subjective religion that Jesus already fulfilled. Don't go back to a legalistic system that Jesus fulfilled on the cross. You're living an amazing reality. Continue it. Hebrews chapter 10. He offered himself as a supreme sacrifice, the propitiation, the Bible says. Once, one time, not annually, one time. That's how perfect it is. That's how perfect it is, for he is the perfect one. So we are living an amazing reality. The writer was bringing to their remembrance, reinforming them, reminding them of their amazing reality that they were living, and not to return. Struggles come, struggles go. Challenges come, challenges go. Tough times come, tough times go. God'll make a way of escape because he's faithful. 1 Corinthians 10, 13. So we are living an amazing reality. Our new life is better than the old life. I want you to, I'm gonna close with this. The new life that you're living, you can take a sheet of paper, split it down the middle, and write all the benefits of the new life you're. Split it down the middle and write the benefits of new life. Of old life. There you go. Benefits of new life versus benefits of old life. And I guarantee you the benefits of your new life in Christ will outweigh the benefits of your old life. I guarantee you. I guarantee you. Because maybe you had some good times. But now we have better times because we all had struggles whether we're Christians or not. The Bible says the way of the transgressor is hard. So we had problems, we had struggles, we had adverse situations and circumstances even before we became a Christian. Now, at least when, as Christians, we know that we can go to God with them and we know that He'll work all things together for the good. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for your goodness, for your love and your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Ah, your word is quick. Your word is powerful. Your word is sharper than any two-edged sword, and your word is good to us. Your word is a blessing to us, and I thank you for it, and I thank you for the people of God, the children of God, Lord, and help us to realize this amazing reality that we have in you, Christ. Help us not to take it for granted. But help us to live in this reality. And I pray that our faith would grow and develop, and this reality would become realer. And what a wonderful word. This reality would become realer to each one of us. We ask these things in your wonderful and blessed name. And we thank you, Lord, as we approach the celebration and the remembrance of your resurrection. We thank you, Lord. And as your writer, as your servant wrote in Philippians chapter 3, I pray that we would all know the power of your resurrection. Your resurrection has given us hope, provided us salvation, provided us assurance, provided us this reality in you, Lord. Though we have not seen you, as Peter wrote, we believe. We have faith, we have trust, we have confidence, and we rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Thank you for this amazing reality, and thank you for the brothers and sisters in Christ. Praise God, praise God. Amen, amen. Have a wonderful resurrection day on Sunday. Enjoy the word of God, enjoy family. Friends, fellowship, food, all those things, and be safe. That's the most important thing. Be safe. All right. And lift up Jesus in the eyes of those who think they know him and those who do not know him. Let us lift up Jesus that they may come to know him. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Amen. All right.